Juan Duoro here. As the time is coming through reading the book of Numbers, the Midbar Hasefer, it is exciting to see how the development of this new generation is coming through. This is to understand that time is a very good teacher sometimes, and at the same time, you need to change your ways of teaching a new generation. I am realizing about that is about myself, you know? There is a tendency to measure everything according to what you went through and what you understand. Times change, but what something that never needs to change is the values that are in the Torah. And I call it values. I am not talking about rules or regulations. That's totally different. The sanctity of life, the right behavior, the respect to the weak, to help the widow and the orphan, to help the people without land, you know, the immigrants, the foreigners. This is part of Torah. Torah teaches us about a relationship with our neighbors, teaches us about a relationship among human beings, respect and reverence to the sanctity of life, I repeat myself. The question is always, what is happening in the world today? Now, the story of Balak is a story about the geopolitical situation that we are living. Can you ask yourself, why this little bitty Israel brings so much in the world sphere, in the world life, you know? Why is almost with Israel, you have only two sides, those who want to destroy Israel and those who want to bless Israel or to keep Israel. You know, there is no middle term, one or the other, two extremes. It is easy to see that the side of wanting to destroy Israel is winning constantly. In all the races, in all the groups, in all the nations. Even the nation that we consider today the most closer to Israel or the allies of Israel, little by little they're turning their back on her. The first thing that we have seen, I see it with trepidation, was started in the middle 70s and 80s with the European nation, when the formation of the Europe United, you know, the United Nations of Europe, and how those countries that were staunch supporters of Israel, little by little they were turning their back to Israel. I can name it to you some of the northern countries of Europe. You can see, for example, Norway, that was a very wonderful country for Israel. Even Finland, you have Denmark, and you have the Sweden. You know, those countries, little by little, they were turning their backs on Israel to the point that today there is more the other side. Another thing that in the geopolitical situation we cannot see, and please take this not as an statement of bigotry, racism, or anything like that. This is not my intention. But there is a very plan taken by the Muslim religion to invade all the world with their doctrines and their dogmas and their religion, and to convert the world to their religion. You know, by the way, Christianity did it in the past. And now you're going to see here Islam now taking a very so-called moderate Muslims, they say that they are not there, very little they say or they condemn even their own imams and their leaders about this catastrophe. In Israel, we had a situation about a man that was very fanatical, and he killed certain Arab people, you know? And everybody in Israel, everyone in Israel, condemned that attitude, okay? Because we are not here to kill. Our God is a God of life. And when Israel kills, you need to understand that it's self-defense. You know, in the Hebrew language, there is a difference between killing and murder. Our Creator said, do not murder. But we have the right to stop those who want to destroy us, because we have the right to keep life. But sometimes those principles have been avoided by the world. You know, the death penalty that most of the more progressive nations of the world now, they are totally against. They don't care about abortion, isn't it interesting? They don't care about euthanasia, because that's just nice and wonderful. But to kill a murderer, to kill a terrorist, to kill somebody who is evil, you need to keep it alive, because their life is more important. This is how our values has changed. And we did not realize about those things until we put a little bit more attention to what we are living. To me, the most scary part, let me put it, or concern part, is about our young people, the new generation, that they are eating and they are almost accepting these new values as the right values. And that goes against Torah, that goes against our Creator, that goes against everything they write. The way, you know, now you ask a young person, do you think this type of behavior is okay? And what they say? Well, it's everybody does it. You know, this is the answer. And to me, this is what is so sad. Because they do not have any longer this idea of what is right and what is wrong. And most of the time, what they think is right is totally against Torah. And we, the older generation, the only thing that we can do is to bow our head and say, well, that's our young people. I refuse to accept that. Because our children are the product of us, we want it or not. With the time, we have even given up the leadership and the of our children to the state, to the government, and we have accepted that the government is wiser than the parents to lead their children to the right place. Now, the government decided what is the right philosophy, what is the right way to think, and that's what everybody needs to be uniform. Here in the scripture, there is a beautiful teaching. And this time, and this parasha, Balak. I want to give you a little overview about this story, and then I'm going to go to certain principles. The story of Balak. The first question among ourselves is how a parasha can have the name of this evil king, Balak, you know? Well, there are many answers about that, but one of the reasons that they put it is there that in the Torah, you know, first of all, the parasha has been made by men, okay? And this portion is to teach us something. It's to teach us about how Israel needs to behave, even though it's not the most popular country in the world, but it has a relationship with our Creator. And it is that relationship of loyalty and conscious Israel has been always trying to be like the other nations. And our Creator keeps telling, you are not like the other nations. You are different. Interestingly, it is Bilam, the prophet by pay, that was called by Balak, the king of the Moabites, no, to curse and destroy Israel, that in one of his, we will say, prophecies or utterance given by our Creator to him, in chapter 23, verse 9, let me read it to you.
Even that
Israel itself doesn't want to fulfill that role anymore. It's too hard, it's too heavy. But even because of that, and maybe consciously, they are doing it. You know? And maybe sometimes without even realizing that they are doing it. All the new things that are coming from the little bit of Israel today, all the new inventions, all the new creations, all the new technological advances for medicine and all other things that come from that little bit of Israel. And sometimes we ask ourselves, what happened with this Israel? You know, a little bit of Israel is considered among the 10 greatest countries in the world. A population no more than 6 million. There must be something there. It has an armed forces that can scare even the greatest powers in the world. More, the little one that they want to fight with Israel. But being so powerful, and they don't use the power, it's only as a detriment to others to say, do deterrent. Not to mess with us, because you're going to suffer the consequences. But they keep being. And it's interesting that the world itself is trying to destroy Israel. You know, I have mentioned to you long before, if you look at the history of the new nation of State of Israel since 1948 to today, and even prior to the inauguration of the State of Israel, already the Jewish people, they have a lot of complaints in the so-called United Nations, in spite of all that Israel went through the Shoah. You know, I believe that the Shoah was a way that our Creator allowed it in order that we could go back to Israel. The problem is that we have confused religion with relationship. And some people have thought that being religious is what makes Israel, instead to understand that if our Creator who made Israel, not us who make our Creator. Our Creator doesn't exist because of us. We exist because of Him. Blessed be His name. We need to start putting the situation in order. Balak has heard already. He knew about this Israel that was under the covering, the Shekhinah. Was under the presence of God Almighty. And they already knew the story about how they left on this very powerful empire like Egypt. And how this Pharaoh with all the power that he was not able to contain to stop Israel. And Israel left. And wherever they went, everybody could say they are being protected by something, someone, by God, by the power, by supernatural ways. How this nation could survive in the middle of the wilderness for so long and being strong. Everybody, that was the talk of the town for 40 years. Everybody was telling each other, all the little kingdoms that were trembling about this wonderful force. King Balak, king of the Moabites. There were a people that Israel was being told very clear not to touch them, not to do war to them. Why? Because they are relatives. You don't fight with your relatives. Keep it away, but I don't fight with them. You know, try to keep a good relationship. Don't fight with your relatives. But there are certain relatives that are better to be enemies than to be friends, no? But that's his life. Israel. Do you know that Israel is still doing that? And only when it's a matter of survival, Israel saved the right to attack. How many of you know about in the early 80s, when the Air Force of Israel destroyed the area that we call in Iraq that they were trying to do the atomic bomb? Do you know? From Iraq, the problem has transferred to Iran. The only thing that they changed was the K for the N, but it's still the same. The problem is the same. But now it's even worse. You know, even in the time of in the 80s, United States and all the world powers who they knew and they were giving all this. You had the Soviet Union at the time. You had all this great power, the Muslim, like Pakistan, giving information and giving technical help to form the atomic bomb. Israel knew about that. The United States knew about that. They had a satellite. They already knew everything. But they wouldn't move one finger. And they knew that if they had an atomic bomb, they were going to use it against Israel. Can you imagine what was going on at that time among these people, among the intelligence services talking about? We have, I call it one of our heroes, you know, Pollard, who is still in jail. A Jewish man, American, working in the intelligence navy, who give information to Israel what United States was hiding from Israel, that was his best ally in the region. Now, you need to be careful what you say are your best friends. Is a nation, a people dwelling alone, not reckoning himself among the other nations. Israel is considered a totally different nation. Even with their own greatest allies, they needed to be not too trusting. And what did Israel do? They bombarded that area. And then later on, United States took all the honor when they defeated, supposedly they defeated Iraq. And there was not any atomic bomb. Because if there was an atomic bomb, I can assure you that they were going to have a lot of problems. Israel saved this great power, saved this great nation. No thanks note, but we have our own people in jail for doing what is right. That tells you something. Can you believe that Pollard is still in jail, dying, and then nobody is going to take him out? Doesn't matter what we say. What is he going to do? I want to teach you a lesson not to betray the United States? This is another issue that I won't have time to develop, to talk too much. But the question is always, you know, our dear sages teach us that whatever country we are, we need to adapt to the laws and to obey the law. But there is a greater principle, the Torah. You know, I will accept everything that the other countries tell me to do, but if they do not go against Torah. If they go against Torah, I need to be careful, I need to be very polite, whatever, but I need to say, I cannot trespass this line. Right now, you know what is going on in the world, about how the values have changed from the Torah, and how they are teaching us to do exactly what the Torah says not to do. And we need to accept it. The saddest part it is that among our own people, who has evolved and now they are open-minded and they are more liberal, you know, they say that it's okay now. This is the problem about when you get too long living in a place in which the values are totally wrong, and you want it or not, you are changed. Then to be faithful to our Creator is not easy. Remember, I am not talking about being religious. I am talking about loyalty and relationship with the Creator. And this is the problem that we get so confused with the year, because we prefer to be religious than to be honest to a relationship with the Creator. We think the rules and regulations are the ones that are going to keep it right with our Creator. When it's not rules and regulations, it's what is here inside us. The intention of our hearts. That is why we need to have the right thing. You have good heart. In the scriptures and good heart, I mean that your relationship with the Creator is right. You don't need to worry about loss. But the problem is that we are twisted. Balak, knowing that this Israel was too powerful, looks for a way to destroy Israel, but he knows that cannot be done through regular means. I need to find the atomic bomb. Okay? Because the regular warfare system doesn't work. Then I'm going to create an atomic bomb that is going to destroy all the nation. And I'm going to hire somebody that supposedly knows the God who protects this country. If you read carefully, this so-called prophet, Goy prophet, you know, Nabi, he is coming from the area that our father Abraham came from, in Aramaic. There are Midrashim that teach us that he was a descendant of Laban. And you know who Laban was? No? The father-in-law, or the father-outlaw, whatever you want to call it, of Jacob. You know? Because Laban had Beor, and Beor had Bilam. Okay? This is a midrash. Okay. Then, but giving us an idea is already that relationship with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob existed with Bilam. But what is interesting? Bilam didn't know Israel. Bilam didn't know exactly what Israel was. Our Creator said, don't touch the people. Because he already knew who was Israel in the beginning. He would say immediately, you're wasting your time, this is impossible. The one that is protecting this is the people of God. God tells Bilam not to curse these people, not to do any damage to these people, because they're a blessed people. He doesn't say, it's my people. No, it's a blessed people. But it means it's a special people. They have a reason to exist. This is the reason that Israel has never been destroyed. Even that all the time of the history of Israel, the only thing that we know is that everybody wants to destroy Israel. And Israel has not been destroyed, not because Israel is the most powerful, the most courageous, or anything like that. It's because some something supernatural is containing the rest of the world not to destroy Israel. That's the reason. I can take credit that because today, for example, in many areas in Israel, there are many people that they think because of the power or the intelligence and the industrial advancement or the technology or the armies that they have, or the wonderful army that they have, the wonderful soldiers that they have, this is the reason that Israel not being destroyed. Be careful with your pride. We are still not being destroyed because He, blessed be His name, is the one that is taking care. Israel, He's the one that doesn't allow Israel to fall. But who is Bilam? Bilam is a prophet for hire. He's a magician. He is a sorcerer. You know? I do favor to one to the one that pays me more. Let me tell you what true it is today. You know, right now we have sorcerers. I'm sorry, as a preacher, we have religious leaders who they preach according to what is better for their pockets. And they're going to tell you whatever you want to hear. And everybody's going to be happy. The ears are going to be, you gotta call it itching. And the words of the ladies are going to be happy. This is Bilam. And Bilam is not interested and listening to God, but he's interested in how much I'm going to receive. And then what is his job? By all means, he's trying to be nice to Balak, but at the same time, he's stuck because he knows that he cannot do anything without the go-ahead from the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He cannot do anything. He's not allowed. He knows that. God has given him certain powers. The question is, why God give to this man power like that? Many people say to show the reality of humanity and also to show us that even when God knows your heart and knows who you are, or even you are walking with God, God give you the free will. At the end, you can decide to do right or to do wrong, even that you know God. And this is one scary part too. Because even knowing God, maybe you can deviate. There's no question about it. Bilam knew who God was. Later on, we are going to see in the next parashat about how Bilam is going to end his life. But he wanted to do something very interesting. Even though he couldn't curse, he couldn't create the atomic bomb against Israel. He tried to create even a worse bomb. How can you destroy Israel? You know, the scriptures say that the earth, the skies, and the heaven, they need to pass away. And then if that happens, you know, Israel is going to disappear. In other ways, Israel will never disappear unless everything disappears. But look at how evil men can be. If Israel has a relationship with the Creator, what I want to do is very interesting. I want to destroy that relationship. I won't curse the nation because I am not allowed to curse. But I want to destroy the image, the turpitude of these people. They are going to do certain things. There's abomination to our Creator, our Creator will be in the situation that he needs to punish Israel. In another simple terms, nobody from outside can destroy Israel, but Israel can destroy himself. This is a big statement and also is a big principle in teaching for all of us. As individuals and as a group, our Creator protects us. But be careful that we destroy ourselves from within, because the outside, they cannot touch us. You know, today everybody is so afraid about the outsiders, the enemies from outside. And the worst enemies can be inside us. Why Israel is not counted as a nation with the other nations? Basically because Israel has been separated to do a function, to have a role. This role has called Or Legoyim, light to the world, to bring the Torah to the rest of the world. How many times have I been teaching this over and over? Look like sometimes it makes sense to certain people, doesn't make to the rest of the world. You know? And it's not interesting that most of the religions now are talking about being delivered from the Torah. We are not any longer under the Torah. We are free of the Torah. And I ask you this question. What the desire of the Creator? To do good for us or to destroy us? Simple logic will give you the answer. You don't need to be a rocket scientist to see the reality. But we as humans, we think that we can do our own business without the need of anybody else's help. It's on our own. Bilam plays the role. You know, our Messiah Yeshua, in the beautiful Sermon on the Mountain that we have, he talked about something very interesting. And the word he said, you know, you cannot have two masters, because you're going to serve one and hate the other. You cannot serve our Creator and you cannot serve Mammon. You cannot serve money. Bilam has two masters. One was the Creator and the other was the money. And what he was more interested to serve? Money. He wanted his pay. Balak offered him a lot. His eyes were coming out of his orbits. He wanted all of that. And this is how he tried to destroy Israel. And he almost does it. It wouldn't be because of the intervention of Pinchas, or Pinejas, that you're going to see in the next parasha. Let me go back to this geopolitical situation. Everybody is looking for the weapon who will destroy Israel. All the nations are getting together. You see, a little bit of Israel, it is not as weak as people think it is. Many people want to think that Israel totally depends on the United States and the superpower for their survival. And sometimes even people in Israel, they think in that way. And we need to start changing our mentality. Our survival depends on us. And depending on us because we depend on the Creator. No anything else. There is no any power greater than our Creator. Basic principle from the Torah. In other words, don't mess with Israel, because you are messing with our Creator. That's in the fact. Now, Israel is misbehaving? Israel is doing wrong? Yes. Israel is terrible? Yes. Sadly enough, telling you, it is. You know? With all the freedom now that we have and all the things that we enjoy, we want to be like the other nation. And more we try to be like the other nation, we go back again. That's the self-destruction. I am more afraid of our behavior in Israel than any other nation outside Israel that want to destroy, including Iran or other Muslim nations that want to destroy Israel. I am more afraid about Israel himself in the behavior, in the relationship with our Creator, than other nations. But nobody wants to say that. Nobody wants to speak that. Because, you see, again, we confuse religion with relationship. I am not telling you to be holier than thou. I am not telling you to be better than anybody else. But I am telling to you to be right. To do the things accordingly. To have the right values. To call right to what is right, to call wrong what is wrong. Don't get involved. Don't be under the oppression of being politically correct, or being religious correct, or being socially correct. Don't fight against the laws of men in the sense that you need to accept them. You need to say honestly, do you know you can give a law, but you won't change my heart. You can say whatever you want to say, but that won't make it right. How many times I have told you that not necessarily democracy, not necessarily majority are right? What happens when a blind is leading the blinds? Where do you go? Who is going to stop you from the cliff? Have you seen those animals who they go and they start running crazy?
The lemming.
They go into the water. You know? This is a problem. How many of us, we are in the same situation? What are we can learn from this parasha today in a practical way? Yes, the nations of the world are looking for the atomic bomb against Israel. Because they know that through regular means they cannot destroy Israel. Israel is very well equipped. We know. Israel is going to defend to the end. For many of us Jewish people, that maybe when the persecution becomes even worse, do you know, we already have our second possibility to flee to Israel. Even in, we have seen already openly in France happening. The French Jews are fleeing back to Israel, buying property and getting things. Why? Because they see what is happening already in Europe. We call it the Islamization of Europe. Here in Canada is happening exactly the same thing, little by little. And it's going to be the idea of the imams, the idea of the Islamists, is that the whole world become one nation in Islam. And what? Those who do not follow Islam, what is the role or the way? Death. No? There is no open mind that you can live in and you can believe in anything else. Do you know, by the way, I don't want to get me out of the knowledge, but this is important to understand, to see how difficult it is. Do you know that Saudi Arabia doesn't allow any Christian church to be built there? I don't talk about synagogue because that would be worse, you know? Okay, not any Christian church. And now Saudi Arabia is building in front of the Vatican one of the largest mosques in Europe. They have the right. Why? Because they are superior. They are more pure. They don't allow the infidel to get in, but we can get in on the infidels and convert the infidels. But the problem is not Saudi Arabia. The problem is Europe, who allowed them to do that. You want to build a mosque here? You need to give me the same reciprocity in your country to be my big church. That is what the Pope needed to say, instead to say that I am praying. This is a problem. Israel is the only country that talks straight. And people don't like it to be talked straight because we are diplomats. And what is a diplomat? It's a hypocrite who talks no sense to say nothing, because they are afraid to hurt anybody. We are in a very difficult times. More and more, we are limited in what we can express and we can say. How long we are going to be able to stand up and speak to you, I don't know. How long they are going to be able to say whatever I want to say, I don't know. But we are living difficult times. You know, if you do not accept a way of life that goes against the core of your beliefs, you are a bigot, you are an extremist, you are a terrorist. That is sad. You know, I honestly believe that everybody has the right to live. And everybody has the right to live the way that they want to live. Unless they do not go against my place. You know, and let me be more clear. You have maybe totally wrong ideas about how you want to live your life. Okay? It's up to you. And then your private life, live it privately. But I don't impose your way of living on me. Don't force me to accept you in that way that you are. You are who you are, that's okay. But don't put it over my face and show me how, you know, right now those parades that they are in all over the world, they call it the pride. Pride of what? Shameless pride. That is wonderful. To be grotesque is pride. But we, those ones who say that's wrong, or those who say we do not agree with that, you know, I don't have any problem that people live the way that they would live, and I won't legislate. Morality cannot be legislated. But don't form your moral values on me. You know? Don't make me to say what is wrong that's right. Balak tried by all means to hold Bilam to say something that he knew that was not right because he was taught not to do it. Then Bilam, what he said? I want the money. Then I go to the back and I'm going to find a way out. Let's not fall in the trap of Milan, because it's going to be worse for us. We have, all of us, a responsibility. The responsibility that we have is not to be, you know, going out to the street and condemning everything is wrong. No. But when you need to speak, speak. Speak honestly. You know, when somebody says, this is so good, and you are polite and you don't say anything, you know? No, I say, I do not agree with you, period. Don't elaborate. Don't try, but be at least honest. Because this is the problem. There is a saying in Spanish. They say, el que calla, otorga. You know, if you keep your mouth shut, you're allowing the others to do whatever they want to do. Or the people are going to accept or think that you have accepted what they say. Do you know that it is a minority most of the time that push their own agendas and they make you believe that it's the majority because the majority doesn't want to say anything? You say, how all of this has to do with Balak and Bilam today? Everything is there. Israel, that supposedly is the country that needs to bring this moral turpitude in all of us, that needs to be the example. Instead to be the example has accepted the way of the world. Because it's better to be accepted by the world than to be rejected by the world. And I'm going to tell this to Israel. Doesn't matter what you do, you're going to be rejected. Doesn't matter how many times you bow your head to the big nations, you're going to be rejected. Because even though they call your friends, they are not your friends. They have you because they need you there. They have you because they are using you. But when you are not useful to them, they won't care to defend you. These are geopolitics. I am so glad that I do not need to trust in men. As Jeremiah Hanabi said, cursed be the man who trusts in men, but blessed be the man who trusts in God. And to my religious fanatic friends, please, give me a break. You have never solved anything with religion. The only thing that with your religion you have to bring more destruction and division. Because the God that we believe in is the only true God. I mean the God for the Jews and for the Gentiles. There is no other God. Because he created all of us. You know, God didn't create only Israel. God created humanity. Yes, Israel, before you existed, God created Adam and Eve. I'm sorry to tell you, they were not Jewish. You know, I say this to my Israel. In order that we need to be a little bit more humble, but let's not forget why we have been created. We have a role to play, and it's very important. We have a responsibility. And as mentioned to you in the parasha before, chapter 15, already the true Israel is not because of the pure blood, but the true Israel is the true calling. And there are many around this world that are true Israelites. And they are there. And our Creator bringing them all together. Let's wait and keep our hopes in Him. Blessed be His name. Let's not get scared about anything. Because fear doesn't come from our Creator. Reverence comes from Him. Fear to our God is reverence. say to the people who do not believe in God,